Welcome to this third edition of SIOR and Author TV presenting Single Surgeon series. And we have today with us Dr. Kailash Patil, who will be speaking on 10 steps to successful TKR. And we have with us Dr. Surendra Patil, CEO at Polaris Hospital, as a panelist to have question and answer session. So over to you, Dr. Kailash. You can share your screen and we can go ahead with the program.
Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes, we can see.
Go ahead. It's good?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you everyone. Good evening everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Ashok Sham and Ortho TV for having me on this platform and giving me this opportunity to speak on Ortho TV. I would also like to thank Dr. Surendra Patil, who is a busy orthopedic surgeon in Pune and owns a hospital of his own. So thank you, Dr. Surendra Patil. As we all know, we get a lot of patients who come in late stage arthritis, and in our OPD, we see these patients with osteoarthritis, and most of the patients, say about 30 to 40% of our practice who are practicing arthroplasty surgeons, they advise to undergo a total knee replacement. A lot of surgeons now have started doing total knee arthroplasty, and a lot of surgeons are just beginners. This talk of mine would just touch upon a few finer important points where we are going to see how to get a good outcome out of a total knee replacement. So my topic today is 10 tips to do a good total knee replacement. So in any surgery for that matter, the principles of a total knee arthroplasty never change. So what we are going to look at is alignment of the knee. That is the femoral alignment, tibial alignment, the intra-articular alignment. We need to know the axes, that is the mechanical, the anatomical axis. And upon that, we decide whether we are getting a good, well-aligned knee or not. The balance is also very important. We always balance the knee in extension first and then in flexion. Next point will be most important is maintaining the joint line. Most of the times, the joint line comes about 1.5 centimeters above the fibular head. And tip of the fibular head. So that is what we are aiming at. The other point is femoral component positioning. So there are three important things which we need to see about these femoral components. That is, we need to restore the offset. We need to have a rotational alignment and lateralization of the femoral component. Last but not the least is proper cement fixation. When we are doing all these kind of surgeries, we are doing these high-risk surgeries, we are doing these high-profile surgeries, we also incur a lot of surgical complications, which may lead to an early total knee arthroplasty failure. So we need to know these points where the knee can fail so that we can avoid these. So these points are delayed wound healing, we can get an infection, that may be hemorrhage inside the knee because of bleeders, arthrofibrosis. This may be intraoperatively where the surgical time just goes on increasing. Second thing is there is a lot of dissection. The knees may be quite stiff preoperatively, and postoperatively the patients may not be conducive to any kind of physiotherapy, or rather the physiotherapy just fails to get them that much amount of range of motion. Malalignment is another issue. Instabilities, which may be most common which we face nowadays, is mid-flexion instabilities. There may be fixation failures. Anterior knee pain is a hot topic to discuss because a lot of literature has been written about anterior knee pain. There may be patellofemoral complications also. So if you go to literature, Saleh et al. Did a meta-analysis of what are the most commonest causes of failure of a total knee arthroplasty. The most commonest came out to be that was instability. As I said, the most common is mid-flexion instability. That ranged to about 28%. Infection was the next common, with implant loosening and migration ranging from about 5 to 20%. So coming to the main topic, what are the tips to have a good outcome? So we need to start right from when the patient enters the OR and starts to get an anesthesia. So what we usually prefer is an epidural hypotensive anesthesia. The second point is preemptive analgesia and pain control. We need to have a proper exposure. we need to have a balanced extension flexion gap and maintenance of the joint line. As I mentioned earlier, the tibial cut should be at about 90 degrees to the anatomical axis. We should always have a proper femoral and tibial sizing and rotation, the proper patellofemoral tracking, proper cementing technique, attention to wound closure, and also the most important is preventive measures that will reduce the amount of infection. So coming to the first point, that is the regional anesthesia. It is, we usually practice three types of anesthesia. That is the spinal anesthesia, the epidural anesthesia, and a combined spinal or epidural anesthesia. It gives a better intra and post-operative management. So most of the knees which are unilateral, primary knees, simple straightforward knees, we use spinal anesthesia. In cases of complex surgeries, complex knees, and when the surgical time is going to increase, we use epidural anesthesia. Most of the time in Sancheria Hospital, we use bilateral cases, we use a combined spinal and epidural anesthesia. So what are the advantages of epidural anesthesia? It provides an excellent pain relief, which can be extended post-operatively. It can be on a regular interval. The cost can be prohibitive at times, and compliance also is a little bit of a problem in some of the patients. Disadvantages, well, it is a technically difficult thing in cases of spinal deformities and ankylosing spondylitis, where the needle just doesn't penetrate the epidural. The epidural hematoma formation may be present if the patient is on antiplatelet agents like an Ecosprin or clopidogrel. Urinary catheter may be required, and at times mobilization may be delayed because of cordyceps weakness. The next point will be preemptive analgesia and pain control. This is most important in cases of patient care and recovery. This should be preemptive analgesia. In the Western countries, they use oxycodone, which is right now not available in India. They use COX-2 inhibitors. They use gabapentin, tramadol, and with the anesthetic cell, you can use a clonidine patch. So what exactly is preemptive analgesia? It's a concept to stay ahead of the pain. It is easier to prevent pain than to treat it. The basic aim of it, of the intervention, is whenever there is pain which is more than 4 on a VAS scale, we go for a preemptive analgesia. Patients also kind of appreciate the concern about the pain which they are going to experience post-operative, and they are prepared for the amount of pain they are going to have after the operation when we are keeping them on these preemptive analgesics and counseling. In India and in our institute, we usually practice that's our protocol. We use a tramadol, which is 50 milligram, or a COX-2 inhibitor, which is 200 to 400 milligram, depends. Pantoprazole, about 40 milligrams, and pregabalin, 75 milligrams. Now, pregabalin, most of the times, you should be very cautious with it, because a lot of times patients may have kind of a drowsiness feeling the next morning during the when going to the OR. So we have to be careful and titrate it accordingly. Now, the most important, the most favorite part of most of the anesthetists nowadays is blocks for analgesia. There are two types of blocks. One is the lumbar spine block, and the other is the sacral plexus block. The lumbar spine is femoral nerve block, or a saphenous nerve block, or an obturator nerve block. Sacral plexus, it is either a posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh, the sciatic block, or the adductor canal block. Now, these blocks, usually what we understand is these should be done by an experienced anesthetist, one who is trained or who is a fellowship trained anesthetist who has done these kind of blocks, and at institutes which do practice this anesthetic blocks, but it's a very good alternative. If you compare, if you go to the literature and see the difference between subsartorial adductor canal versus a femoral nerve block, the adductor canal block seems to be having an edge over a femoral nerve block, and it's an attractive alternative to femoral nerve block because of its potentially lower overall impact if a neuropraxia should occur. So it's a single shot indwelling catheter which is placed with a C-arm. It provides good analgesia and can be kept for about 24 to 48 hours. Urinary catheter can be avoided and allows mobility in bed. Motor weakness is minimal. So now, adductor canal blocks, most of the times we are using these in daycare surgeries. There is a new concept which has come in totally arthroplasties. That is, it is coming a daycare surgery or a single day surgery. And these adductor canals are really a boon in these cases. The next point is intraoperative injections, or the ROC cocktail. The Ranawat Orthopedic Center cocktail includes marcaine, morphine, adrenaline, antibiotic, and corticosteroids, and normal saline. So most of the times what we practice usually is we don't use steroids in cases of diabetics, immunocompromised, and in cases of age which is more than 70 years. Earlier it was 80 years, now we have reduced it to 70 years. But most of the times steroids, we make it a point to avoid. So there are various cocktail protocols which are available. There may be a Ranawat cocktail, a Mulaji cocktail, and so on and so forth. But it depends how you skin the cat, and you need to titrate it according to what you need. There are two types of injections which we usually use. That is the ROC cocktail, and in the injection A, and injection B has about 0.5% marcaine with saline. So in our institute, our protocol is we use bupivacaine about 0.25%. We use adrenaline, we use a cefuroxime, that is an antibiotic, and also normal saline. And in injection B, we use again 0.25% of bupivacaine with saline, about 40 ml. So the first solution is about 60 ml and the second is about 40 ml. Now, the most important part is where are we exactly going to give these injections? So prior to the insertion of a liner and reduction, use, because your posterior capsule is open, your posteromedial and lateral structures are open, we give it in the posterior capsule and the posteromedial and posterolateral structures. Now, these are the most sensitive areas of your knee, and that is the point where you're really going to, the patient is really going to have pain. And this is that is why most of the patients post-operative, they end up with a flexion kind of a deformity, and because of the pain, because of the contracture of your posterior capsule, and that is the strongest part of your capsule. So if there is no pain, most of the patients are comfortable in these areas. Once the reduction is done, you need to give it in the extensor mechanism. You start clockwise. You start from the extensor mechanism, you give it in the synovium, you come down to the medial side, give it in the pes anserinus, anteromedial capsule, and the periosteum. You go on to the lateral side, that is the IT band, and then go on to the collateral ligaments and their origins. The third point would be a surgical exposure. So surgical exposures, you can either go by the conventional way where you're doing a distal femoral cut, then a proximal tibial cut, and then going back to the femur and doing all the cuts of the femur. Or you can use what is called as a Ransal's maneuver, that is the Ranawat and Insal's maneuver, where they remove all the osteophytes, they remove the cruciates, they take care of the vanicula and the lateral gutter, evert the patella completely, and then take out the tibia first. So they always do what is called as a tibia first, and then they align the femur according to the tibial cut. So that is called as a... So in any ways, in either you do a conventional or you are going to do a Ransal maneuver, what you are usually trying to aim at is avoiding any kind of a vascular injury, removal of all the cementophytes, and in cases of patellar tendon avulsion, you are avoiding the biggest complication the knee can have. Now, coming to once you are done with all of this, you're going inside the knee, what you're starting with your cuts. So you need to balance the knee in flexion and extension, and also maintenance of the joint line. So you need to remove enough proximal tibia, that is about 8 to 10 millimeters, not more than that. You need to remove the distal femoral cut, that is also about 8 to 10 millimeters. Now, anything above this and you are going to change the joint line. So you should aim at about 8 to 10 millimeters. So 9 millimeters is the average which you are going to get. Extension gap first, you should balance that it should be a rectangular gap, and then go on to the flexion gap by using the parallel to the tibia cut technique. Now, what is the concept of balancing the balance technique in TKRs? Is balance the extension gap, you should always get a rectangular gap, which is about 10 to 12 millimeters, and it should exactly match your flexion gap. This was introduced in about 1991, and the origin of this balanced extension gap first technique was started. And once you have done with your extension gap, you go on to the flexion gap, and try and see if you're going to get, you always use a 3 degrees external rotation jig so that you can get a rectangular gap. If not, you're getting a flexure, you're getting a trapezoidal gap. Don't go and immediately rotate it. A few of my colleagues, do a little bit of release and see if the knee is opening up on that medial side. You go posterior to your medial condyle and do a little bit of release of the capsule. At times we can get away without even rotation of the component, and we can get away with a balanced flexion gap. The method to judge the tibial cut is also very important. Tibia cut should always be about 90 degrees to the long axis of the tibia, if the rod is in the middle of the tibia. Now, you need to remember 3 points. Basically, it's the medial point of the lateral tibial eminence. It's the medial border of your tibial tuberosity. You have to go along the shin of the tibia and see where your tibialis anterior tendon is, or the second metatarsal. So all these points can give you a generalized idea of whether you are going to get a 90 degrees cut along the long axis of the tibia. So I usually don't prefer the fourth point, that is the tibial shin, because a lot of times these tibias may have a tibia vara and you might have a different cut than what you're expecting. The other method is parallel to the ground technique, where you are going to have a cut which is going to be absolutely parallel to the ground. Now coming to the proper tibial sizing and rotation. So in this case, the size of the tibial tray should be always used, always done using the lateral tibial cut surface. So the most important part is you need to expose the tibia completely. It should be exposed 360 degrees when you're going to take a cut. So most of the times what we find is on the lateral side, there is always a little bit of struggle to get that patella out of its place. There is a little bit of overhang of that patellar fat pad, and we need to make sure that it is completely out of the way. And you should coagulate inferior geniculate, lateral geniculate artery, and see that there is no bleeder. Once you have taken the cut, what you do is mark that lateral border completely, so that you can place your tibial sizer on that exact posterior lateral surface, which is matching to the posterolateral surface, and also the anteromedial surface. So you should always match to the lateral border, the posterolateral border, the anteromedial border. So these are your reference points for your sizing of the tibial cut. Whatever excess bone you are going to get. Now, this is what I'm talking about, a varus knee. Most of the times, varus knee, we are doing 80% of the times we are doing varus knees. So what I'm talking about is a varus knee. We just need to remove that excess bone on the medial side. Either you use a saw or you can use a ronger and take out that excess bone and sculpt that medial tibial plateau. Once the tibial sizing is done, you start with the femoral sizing and rotation. You should always have a special attention to the sizing of the anteroposterior femur to restore the posterior offset. And you should also size anterior referencing in order to avoid notching. Now, there are multiple ways where you're going to size the femur. You can either do it by multi-point referencing, you can do it by anterior referencing, or you can do it by posterior referencing. What we usually practice is we use a multi-point referencing where mediolateral, anteroposterior, all the dimensions are taken into view. And then we go ahead with the sizing of the femur. Coming to proper patellofemoral tracking, we should always minimize the lateral release. Correct the femoral sizes. You should have the exact size of the femur. Avoid any kind of femoral internal rotation. Lateralize the femur and tibial components. Maximize the patellar coverage. And test the patellar tracking without a tourniquet. So always make sure that your patellar tracking is having a no thumb technique, where you're going to push the patella towards the medial side with your thumb and then get the tracking right. It should not happen. The patella should track free of any kind of force applied on it. And that's how you get your patellar tracking normal. When you're sizing the patella, always make sure that the patella is completely covering your cut surface, because if you're going to undersize it, there is a little bit of bone which is remaining on the sides, and there is a lot of fat pad as well as a little bit of tissue which is there, which might, you know, just grow over the patella, and it might cause a little bit of clunk in the future. So as far as possible, size it absolutely maximal to the cut surface. When you are positioning the patella, do it a little bit about 2 millimeters lateral to the midline of the patella, so that your patella again tracks well in your trochlear groove. Now, the most important, once you've done all the cuts, everything is done, you're balanced, your trials are in, and you are going to, you're getting a good balanced knee. The most important and point comes the proper cementing technique. So you should always make it a point that you're going to apply the cement at what state. It should be at a dovey state and to the prepared bony surfaces and implant, and then pressurize. So there are 3 ways where you can do this. One, you can apply the cement on the cut surfaces. One, the other is you can apply the cement only on the implants itself, or else you can apply it on both the cut surfaces as well as implant. So most of the literature is very divided upon this, but the literature does support that when you are going to apply cement, you use it on both the surfaces so that you get a good interlocking inside the bone, inside the trabeculae. Make sure that when you are pressurizing the cement, you should pressurize to a point where your fingers are going to blanch, where your thumb or fingers are going to blanch. So that is the amount of pressure which you are going to apply when you are putting the cement on the cut surfaces. In cases of sclerotic bone, make sure that you make a little bit of drill holes in the bone so that there is good penetration of the cement. The general idea is you need to put in cement to about 2 to 5 millimeters inside the bone. And that should really give you a good interlock or interface between the implant and the bone and the cement. The next point will be attention to wound closure. Now, a lot of surgeons have different ways to close a wound, but what we usually practice is closure in a flexion mode without a tourniquet and with good approximation of all the layers. So the capsule, I make it a point that I take it once the cement sets, I put in a lot of mops and release the tourniquet. Slowly I take out the mops, coagulate all the bleeders, and then start the closure. One, I do it in two layers. One is intermittent closure of the wound, of the capsule, and the second is a continuous. So I get a good tamponade effect. So whatever remaining vessels or bleeders are there inside, they may, you know, they get coagulated or they get stopped. And then the skin and subcutaneous layers. You can either close the skin with a staple or subcuticular sutures, whatever suits you and whatever you are comfortable with and gives you a good night's sleep. The next most important thing, after you've done everything right and everything might go wrong with one, just one thing, and that is an infection. So you take all your proper necessary measures to reduce the infection. Always use prophylactic antibiotics within an hour of your surgery. Modern draping and sterilization techniques should be used. Use disposable gowns. They are not very expensive. They're quite cheap and you can always use it in a surgery like this. Avoid unnecessary OR traffic. So this is very important. What I make sure is that in my OR, I make sure that there are not more than 5 people who are not at all going out of the OR. All the infantry, whichever you need, whatever you need, keep it in the OR itself. There are certain ORs in the country where you get a little bit of a window where you can ask for something from outside the OR, but make sure that your doors don't open up again and again. Because see, most of these ORs are modular ORs and these are having negative pressure flows. So once you open it up, all the dirty air comes in and you're going to have trouble with that. So that is one thing. Lock your OR at all the times. Once you're done with the OR traffic, you always consider using hoods and laminar flow. Again, the literature is quite divided upon using hoods and laminar flow. So it's not completely agreed upon the point that you have to use a hood and a laminar flow. It may or may not be used, but having at least a laminar flow is a good idea. Limit the duration of the entire procedure. So it should not go beyond 60 to 90 minutes. That's the generalized time which you should take for a unilateral total knee replacement. And it should not go beyond it unless until it is a revision surgery or a complex deformity. You should always inform your anesthetist what is the amount of time you're going to take exactly, or roundabout approximately that is the amount of time which I'm going to take for this surgery, so that the anesthetist is prepared and the staff is also prepared for the time which you're going to take. You should always do a meticulous wound closure. So that is your first line of defense whenever you are looking at a total knee arthroplasty, and their first line of defense in case an infection does tend to occur. So these are a couple. These are a few X-rays of of a unilateral knee. This is what you're going to look in an X-ray. You should have proper sizing of the femur and the tibia. You should have good cementing all around and a good aligned knee, and that should give you a good result. So in summary, what you should know is you have to have a hypotensive epidural anesthesia, a preemptive analgesia and pain control, a proper exposure. Most important is balanced extension flexion gaps and the maintenance of a joint line. Your tibial cut should be at 90 degrees to the anatomical axis. A proper femoral and tibial sizing and rotation. Proper femoral, patellofemoral tracking. A proper cementing technique. attention to wound closure, and you should always have all the preventive measures to reduce any kind of infection in these knees. I thank you, everyone. That's the end of my talk, and over to you, Dr. Ashok and Dr. Surendra Patel. I hope I did not take a lot of time, and it was quite informative, I hope.
Thank you, Dr. Kailash. It was really crisp talk, and in around 25 minutes, you have given the entire gist of primary TKR, and very useful for any surgeon who is starting his practice in arthroplasty. Dr. Surendra, you have any comments or questions for Dr. Kailash?
Kailash, first of all, I would congratulate you. It's a very nicely and crisply made talk. The salient features, the basics of the TKR, which has to be considered while for a final and a good successful outcome of a knee replacement surgery, has been very well touched by you. As you rightly said, it is like a soft tissue surgery more than a bony surgery.
Absolutely.
I would like to ask you a question, that since the majority of the failures which comes up into, if it fails, the primary reason for it is for the failure is an instability. What are the ways, can you enlighten us, like what are the ways in which you can prevent instabilities by doing, in terms of soft tissue releases intraoperatively or commenting on the bony cuts?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. So what we need to understand is most of the times what we are going to look at is two kind of things. One is a varus knee, which is the most common, which is going to be like about 80% of your practice. And then there are valgus knees, which are about 10 to 20% of our practice. So if you cannot compare apples and oranges, these two are completely different ball games. So if you are going to go in for a varus knee, most of the times what we are looking at is we are going to release the medial side first. So what I usually do is I don't go too distally when I'm releasing that MCL. I make it a point that whatever I require, the amount of MCL release which I do in the first go, it's going to be only for my tibia to come out, not more than that. No, I'm not going to go and aim for the end balance immediately, because you never know whether your MCL is tight, your posteromedial structures are tight, or your superficial MCL is going to be tight. So either of these structures, you're not going to release at the first go. If you do that immediately at the first go, what you're going to have is a knee which is going to be a completely imbalanced knee. So you go stepwise. There should be a sequence of release. You should not go and immediately release everything. So you go stepwise. You do a little bit of release of your MCL. Then you go and see if your knee is balancing. Then you go to your posteromedial structures. Even if then you are not getting, do a little bit of capsular release. Even if you are not getting that, then you do some kind of a procedure called as a pie crusting, where you do multiple punctures in the MCL and then see. Even then, if you are not going to get a balanced knee, you can go in and release the superficial MCL right up to its distal point. So the superficial MCL is about 6 to 8 inches below your joint line. So you should go about 6 to 8 inches below the joint line. And you should always make it a point that you go below your pes anserinus. Because your pes anserinus is one of the structures which is going to hold your medial side a little in extension. At times, you can get only a knee which is imbalanced in flexion, but it is balanced in extension. That is because of your pes. In flexion, once you release the MCL, it's gone. And your pes is going to hold the knee together in your extension. So you should be always aware of this. So you, whenever you're going to release your superficial MCL, always go below the pes anserinus. And if you're really worried about that your knee is not really balanced, you should always have a constraint as a backup. You should always have a constraint as a backup, because if you're over-releasing your knee and if you're having an imbalanced knee, that is not going to give, no amount of plasters or no amount of immobilization is going to balance that knee ever again. So that is about a varus knee. Once you are going in for a valgus knee, again, the same thing applies here. Only thing is the amount of structures which are going to support your valgus knee. There are a lot of structures on the lateral side, not like a medial side where there is only one MCL which is going to support your medial side. And on the lateral side, there is the LCL, there is the IT band, there is your posterior oblique ligament, there is your PLC, posterolateral corner, and your capsule. So all these structures are there on the lateral side. So there is a lot of support on the lateral side. It is unlikely that a valgus knee goes into a sudden imbalance. But still, even in such cases, you have to have a little bit of what we call a sequential release on the lateral side. So you pycrust the IT band and see if you're going to get a balanced knee. You do a little bit of release of the posterolateral corner. At times, we can find that once you're doing your posterolateral corner, it suddenly pops out and you get a balanced knee in a very tight valgus knee. So that's in cases of valgus knee. So the most important point in both these cases is a sequential release.
Right. So the thing is that you do a release, again check it. Yes. If you're not still not satisfied, that's then you right. go for the next step.
Right. So
that's a very nicely you had explained it. One more thing, like as you mentioned that we and what standard the book says, like you know, we need to take around average 9 millimeters from either side, so right. from that's the tibia and femur. But I think when we are doing
Hello. Hello?
Yeah, he'll be back. His internet is upstairs.
Okay.
Bony cuts.
Sorry, I couldn't get that question. Your internet was down.
Oh, is it? I'm saying if there's a hyperlaxity,
yes.
So in that scenario, we need to minimize the bony cuts,
yes.
With the standard bone cuts, which we take for the distal femur or the proximal tibia of around 8 to 10 millimeters.
Right.
So I'm just mentioning that in case of, one need to be careful in terms of hyperlaxity and
absolutely,
we need to minimize
absolutely.
Bone cuts out there.
That's a good point. One
more question is like, there are many antibiotic where comes for the cocktail regimes. There are many.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir.
Are you?
Yes, sir. What we'll do is we'll off your video for some time, then we can hear your audio. Go ahead, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead, sir. So I think his question was about the cocktail, various antibiotics has been used.
Yes.
So which one you prefer and why?
So at Facility Hospital, we have standardized it at cefuroxime. That is a third generation cephalosporin. And most of the places all around the world, they do use a broad spectrum kind of an antibiotic. Gram positive as well as a gram negative cover, but most of the time we see that these infections are with gram positive organisms, so we use a cephalosporin or third generation cephalosporin in such cases. Hello.
Yeah. I think we are not getting connected to Dr. Surendra.
Okay.
So let me check if I have any more questions.
Sure.
Yeah. Meanwhile, Dr. Surendra can join in.
So most of the places where they are using these cocktails, a couple of things we need to know that few places they may use epinephrine, they may use steroids. But using a steroid in total knee arthroplasty is a little bit questionable, because most of the times what they say is steroids can lead to tissue degeneration as well as antibiotics, as well as infection, increased chances of infection. So steroids we don't use at Sancheti Hospital completely. We have completely abandoned using steroids in these cocktails. That is one point. The other point which Dr. Surendra Patil brought out was hyperlaxity. So in cases of hyperlax knees, we need to first see whether it's an hyperextending knee or a just lax, mediolateral lax knee. In cases of a hyperextended knee, always it's a good idea to keep constraint as an implant of choice. And in cases of mediolateral laxity, as Dr. Surendra Patil already mentioned, we need to reduce the amount of cuts which you are going to take. So just a sliver of metal where sliver of the bone where we can make the implant sit, that is more than enough. So you need not go by the conventional method of using a 9 millimeter cut. You can reduce it up to 7 millimeters also. The amount of gap which you're going to get after an hyperlax knee can be reduced to about even about 9 millimeters to 10 millimeters. And nowadays there are implants which are available, which are say about, they start right from 6 millimeters of an insert size going up right up to 24 millimeters. So that's the amount of range which is now available of these inserts. So we can get away with a reduced cut also. Yes, Dr. Surendra is back online, I guess.
Yep. I think there was some internet issue at my end.
Yes.
Yeah, go ahead, sir.
I think he has nicely summarized everything. I would like to ask a final question about what is your take on this reduced tissue trauma protocols?
Well, reduced trauma tissue protocols, see, basically, a lot of times we use these minimally invasive surgeries where we are going to use either a subvastus approach, you're going to use minimally incisions and reduce only doing the femur, the amount of implant which is going to go in, that is the amount of incision which you're going to take, and that is the amount of dissection which you're going to take. So I in initial stages, if you're going to ask me about patient, about surgeons who are going to start off doing these surgeries, I would rather stay away from these reduced trauma surgeries. Let them take incisions which they are comfortable with. They should be able to expose the whole joint properly so that they can get the releases right, everything right, exactly. And then they can slowly move on to reduced trauma protocols. So that would be my take on these reduced trauma protocols.
I agree with you. In the early stages, when you are on the learning side, I think better exposure is more important to get a proper balancing of the joint and getting the component well in alignment. So I agree with you. And as you become more proficient with the technique, then you can reduce on the incisions and can take efforts to reduce the tissue trauma.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Thank you. I think any other question from the viewers is there? Ashok? Ashok?
Yeah.
Is there any question from the viewers?
Yeah, there was one question about thromboprophylaxis regime after primary TKA. So what do you follow and recommend?
Right. So what I usually follow is we give 0.6 milligram of Clexin as a bolus dose and then put the patient on 0.4 milligrams. So this continues till the patient is mobilized. Once the patient is mobilized, we put them on Ecosprin or aspirin for a period of about 3 to 4 weeks. Till the patient is completely mobilized. We at times do use mechanical pumps and all for thromboprophylaxis, but not regularly. Because once we make the patient stand in about 4 hours time, and that is why we don't use too much of thromboprophylaxis. Because once the patient is mobilized, I don't think they really require that amount of
I think early mobilization is the crux. And for getting the early mobilization, we need to have a better pain control.
Yes.
And by using this cocktail regimes and pain management, one can easily achieve it very well.
Right.